Oh, Tux. Tuxy buddy, come on. Come on, let's go. Good boy. Good boy. Here you go. Yeah. That's my buddy. Good morning. Good morning.
Well, I am out here 30 minutes earlier. It's just as dark as ever. I'm sure Morris will show up soon.
You are.
Good boy. Good morning, Morris.
Hi. Hello, buddy.
Since he's so spooky, I have to make sure to pet him a little bit every morning. He needs that person contact. Good boy. Good boy. I don't know if you can see it or not, but there's a huge spider web there. It gets to be spider web season right now. Everybody's doing good. I made sure they all got good food and water before we take off for the day. Are we ready?
We're going on a field trip with Johnny.
Well, we're going on our own field trip.
Oh, but he gets to go on a field trip. You know, the whole time I was in school,
oh,
I think I went on like 3 field trips. And I mean, one of the field trips was like to the lot next door to clean it up.
I was going to say was a 5-mile hike in the snow that you didn't get in Alabama.
The autopilot convenience features unavailable. He doesn't have autopilot.
Well, the last time I got out and got back in when we had that temporarily, it came back. So hopefully, because we sure don't want to drive all the way up to Virginia border today and not have autopilot. Don will be ready to shoot me. Well, I'm a little surprised FNB is all red, white, and blue. And the PNC too. It's changing a little bit up there. I don't usually get to enjoy the changing building decorative lights because by the time we get downtown, the sun's up and they've shut off. They shut off at like, you know, 7 or 7:15 and we're coming through at 7:15 and they're just off by then, but cool. Advantages of a half an hour early and dawn driving. It was less traffic too.
Oh yeah, there was no traffic.
Yeah, traffic was really reasonable. Alright, Johnny's dropped off over here by the football field. The bus isn't here yet. He's about 10-15 minutes early, but he's with a friend, so all is good.
Yeah, they're
practicing football on the field. Some of the people are up exercising. Wow, they got a real tour bus today going in style, baby.
Yeah.
First off, it's still dark out. And I was just going to see, did you see Halifax? Scroll, there's Halifax. So how long to get to that supercharger? Because that's like 15 minutes from the solar farm.
Right.
So, excuse me. So, 8:07, an hour and 9 minutes to get to Halifax. Maybe that's, wow, that just seems really short.
78 miles. That's about right.
Okay. And 34%, so obviously we're good. And add a stop. Darn cough. Yeah, I'm still coughing. And then, of course, I cough. And the more I cough, the more I cough. You know, it just irritates my throat and it makes it work. Center for Energy Education? Come on.
Yes, Roanoke Rapids.
Yeah, that's it. Airport Road. I was just curious how long to get from the supercharger to the solar farm. Yeah, like 12 minutes.
Yeah, that's about right.
That's about, well, I said 15, so yeah, that's about right. All right, well, we're going to think about where we want to walk because we really, being there at 9:30 would be good. This has us getting there at 8:20.
Yeah.
So we got to think. So there's a canal system in Roanoke Rapids, which we didn't know about. So we're really close to the Virginia border when we're up here. The car is really helpful in planning here. So if we go past the supercharger and go straight to the trailhead, which is sort of in the middle of downtown Roanoke Rapids, we'll get there at 8:30. And it's approximately, let's just say, 10 minutes over to the Center for Energy Education, which is off of Highway 158 Airport Road. And that, it's really close. And then on the way home, we'll stop back at the supercharger. And we're going to get to the Center for Energy Education at 28%. We're not going to do anything but run the light show. And we'll get back to the supercharger. Let's just say even at 15%, we'll be fine. So we got a plan. We got a nice new place to walk and a plan to be. We'll probably walk for 45 minutes. Well, Ruby rebooted the center screen this time. The last time I didn't have autopilot. When she rebooted the driver instrument cluster, that's when it came back. We haven't driven enough to know yet. We're just basically out of the park and at the first stoplight. So, and at the intersection, she would not normally offer autopilot till you were through the intersection. So we're cutting over to 64 off the Beltline now. Woo, there's the sun. Don says it's good. We're going to walk when we get up there because the sun will be out and it'll be warmer. It's actually not that cold. It's 55. But we're on 64 East and we will be until we hit 95 near Rocky Mount. So I was telling Don that in the What's Up Fuquay-Varina Facebook group yesterday, somebody made a really snotty comment about, I used to live in Florida, there's lots of them EV drivers down there, I bet they're not doing so well after the storm because they can't charge their car, blah, blah, blah. And I, you know, probably just should have let it go because you know you can't convince people that think that like that about anything else, but I just couldn't. So I Googled supercharger status, Tesla supercharger status Florida, and the owners group in Florida had put out a list of all the superchargers and what their status was, and even the one in Fort Myers was up and running. A matter of fact, I don't think there were any in the list that were down. Maybe a few days ago there were a few that were down, but there weren't any in the list. So if you didn't have power at home, you could go to the supercharger, right? And I'm not saying there's not a line at the supercharger, possibly, blah, 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 I don't know, but just to say that EV owners have no place to charge their car down there in Florida due to the storm is not an accurate statement. So Don had told, you know, the standard comeback to that is, well, you can't pump gas without electricity. You're not going to be able to fill up your gas car either. And that's most likely sort of true, but that's not quite an accurate statement because, well, in Florida, I looked up the law. The major gasoline companies are now required to have a transfer switch installed, which means that they have the ability to switch over to generator power, but they are not required to have a generator on site. The law reads something along the lines of, within 24 hours of losing power, they need to deploy generators where they need them, which sounds reasonable to me. You know, it's a big expense to have a generator sitting there all the time that gets used rarely. And but there is some provisions there, and smaller mom and pop places don't have to have the transfer switch or the generator because it is a cost burden to smaller businesses, whatever. Oh, and it was only if you're on an evacuation route. So that doesn't mean the gas station in your little town has to have it. Although I guess the farther north in Florida, you could argue a lot of the roads are evacuation routes, but it is on the major roads, not all over. And I'm sure there's a lot more detail somewhere, but it was really hard to find this information. And we were trying to understand if North Carolina has this law or not. And really, Google was not helping me figure this out. But probably there are some gas stations and bigger companies in most states now that have the ability to turn on a generator, deploy a generator, or whatever. But, you know, it probably is somewhere true, yeah, you can't power gas without electricity, but you might be able to use Gas Buddy to find a gas station that has gas, that's pumping gas, that has a generator. And Don, you know, sometimes he follows the guys on the unicycle, and Duff down in Florida, he lives near Fort Myers. He's not too far from the hurricane area. And his house and he and his Model Y or 3 now?
Model Y.
Yeah, I think he traded his 3 for a Y. He fared fine. Even his chickens, I think, are okay, and his solar panels. But he drove past some gas stations just kind of out and about talking about what was going on. And He showed the gas stations where they were pumping gas, but there was 100 cars in line. So I don't know. My point is just that I shut up this guy, I think, by answering his snotty statement that he didn't even need to make. The post was, why did gas prices jump 30 cents a gallon yesterday? And the answer was, it was in response to the thing the OPEC announced about raising the, I guess they didn't raise the barrel price, but they reduced the capacity. That's what they did. They reduced how much they're going to output. They're going to make less available whenever there's less available, then the price goes up. So, although you could argue that the price hadn't really already gone up yesterday because they still had plenty around, but I don't know. As an EV owner, I just sort of wanted to know about this generator thing at gas stations, because you will run into people that, you know, automatically assume EVs can't charge after a storm or whatever. And really, in Fort Myers and a lot of those places along the coast where the infrastructure was devastated, people were under mandatory evacuation. So really the question is, was there electricity available prior to the storm for you to charge at your home or at a charger to get out of the area? And I also told Don, I think, you know, with 250 miles of range or 250 miles worth of gasoline range, you're going to be able to get out of the evacuation zone, which is really the most important thing. So, but haters going to hate, and I just like to be informed. So this is Dominion Electric's dam along the, river? Yeah. Up here in Roanoke Rapids. It's really pretty. It's bigger than I realized it was going to be. We're going to walk to find the trailhead. Obviously, the trail doesn't let you get too close to the actual dam on the Dominion Electric property, but it does walk along the water. Welcome to Roanoke Rapids Hydroelectric Project, constructed, owned, and operated by Virginia Electric and Power Company under Federal Energy Regulatory Commission license number 2009. It's Dominion Energy, I might have said electric. And this is some sort of a hydraulic turbine, it says.
Yeah, this is the thing that turns the generator shaft.
Adjustable blade propeller type. 35,000 horsepower. Newport News Shipbuilding and Dry Dock Company, Newport News, Virginia. This was built in 1954, it says. Yeah. Be hard pressed to find us building stuff like this anymore. Very cool. Come around. Well, after studying the map from where we are to number 5 is the museum, is they say it's a 45-minute walk, and we've only got 45 minutes. So we should be able to get to number 4 Power Canal Bulkhead and turn around. I told Don we're gonna have to come back. I'm going to want to walk this thing on another day. Live and learn. We are walking on a valid legal trail. Don just says it's just part is washed out. There's some more asphalt up ahead. But you can see the backside of the dam here. Although, since I'm in a really dark spot and that's really bright, it's kind of getting washed out on the video. Well, there it is. You can see the part of the dam where the water flows through over here. And we're coming up on maybe being able to see the water was really pretty on the other side of the dam, but the trail didn't go that way. Well, at least not in the parking lot that we parked at.
Right.
We'll have to study it some more.
It looks like there might be a walkway across the river up here.
Yep. Wow. You can see how high the water gets sometimes.
Oh yeah, well there's...
There's a cormorant down there in the water. I don't know if you can see him moving or not.
Yeah, there's no water coming over any of the spillways.
Yeah.
So the only water is coming through is going through the generators.
Huh. Unfortunately, my 25-minute timer's going off, which means we've got to turn around, but at least we got this far. We will be coming back. Well, we won't have walked our normal distance, but I'll still have in my 30 exercise minutes in. The incline here is just a little bit, but back there it was pretty good.
we could definitely feel we were using some muscles in our legs to navigate this uneven, you know, the walk back up from the water. So it's plenty good workout. Well, they have a fantastic turnout this morning. And I don't even think all of the high school and the kids and stuff are here, although the marching band is. Wow. Well, look at those fine two Teslas this morning. So there's a story about the flags, and apparently they've traveled all over the world and hung out at various locations, and they just found out that they're going to get to keep them here as the final spot. And they were all lit up. They had a little celebration last night about the flags. But I think here looks like a great, great choice for them because they all are energy and renewables themed. Lots of different catering today. Some of the energy related vendors. Probably over 300 high school kids going to come through today.
Yeah.
We red, white, and blue now. We just need an S. Thank you, Ruby. They changed it so it puts the windows back up at the end.
Ah, this one might be Halloween. Yeah, where the other car is
around. I'll try Ruby again in a minute. Lift the up arrow. Open it back up. Can you figure out on the big screen? Hit the little car in the lower left-hand corner. X out of that window. Yep, and then open your door. You should see it on there.
Oh, your screen is big.
Yeah, my screen is big. That's right. Good deal.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Stay back, please. He wasn't here when I asked him. He walked up later. Love those Ruby Tesla smiles. Oh my goodness, they're all so cute. They got their lunch and they're going to eat. Oh my God, it's so cute. Hi, Mr. Ambulance Man. Oh, are you winking at me? You're so cute. Are you gonna come rescue me in an emergency? I thought so. Make it do it again. He talks. He sounds very cool. Oh, I missed it. They were like, whoa. You guys are awesome. This car's 5 years old and has 100,000 miles on it. So the seats have held up really well. They're so cute and well behaved. She's gonna do something else now. Watch. Okay, I want all my kid groups to be in kindergarten.
Look at the condor. Oh,
thank you for coming to visit Ruby. You guys are awesome.
That's a great group of kids.
Yeah. Wow.
You're welcome.
Oh, it's wonderful.
They're equally enamored with David's car. The window dance and the trunk and the charge flap going. The mirror, side mirrors. It's a good show. It's going on 2:30 and we're heading out. We saw all the kids, and then after the kids had to go back to school. There's the blue three. We did talk to a lot of interested adults and some of the politicians from the local area and some of the people from the electric companies that here. The guys at Roanoke, they're awesome. And Roanoke Electric, I'm trying, cooperative guys here. They're awesome. And I think we're going to go, where are we headed?
Yeah,
what are we going
to
do?
Back to the museum or
the
whatever.
Canal. Go look at something else over there before we head back, yeah. So we can meet up with Johnny. I'll keep an eye on his ETA to downtown, and
right.
We've got a little bit of time to spare and enough charge to go back to the canal before we go to the supercharger.
Exactly.
And there's David.
Yep.
He's headed out. He got the supercharge on the way in, so. Donnie, just what I always wanted. A picture of Ruby in front of the wastewater treatment plant here in Roanoke Rapids. smells fine here, though. So, we were over here this morning. And we worked our way across town. It was lots of little turns. It was not so easy to get over across 95. Well, now we're over here at the aqueduct parking lot. So it's 0.2 miles to get to it.
And when we leave here, we're probably going to go down here because this is not that far. And this is 301, so that's a big road, and that'll take us back to 95. So this won't be, and we can check out this spot.
The falls and the parking at that location here would not be good for a bunch of Teslas to show up. Although I suppose, you know, there's room for five people on the grass over there if we had to, but we're just thinking about a meetup potential to get people to come out like we did over at Rocky Mountain the one time. Yeah, that's just the same map over there. Oh God, I don't want to go there. All right, the aqueduct overlook is this way. Be nice and cool. Those hinges.
It's actually good.
What?
Cool.
Yep.
That is only 0.2 miles.
Right. Piece of cake. I hear water. That is an odd looking bench.
That's a substantial bench there, Stevie.
A. Edwin Akers Aqueduct Park in memory of his dedicated service to preserve the Roanoke Navigation Canal and establish the Roanoke Canal Trail. Way cool. So I guess the regular trail is to the left, but the overlook is to the right here. The thing we just walked over is what we're gonna see, the underneath part.
So it says the aqueduct bridging Cody Creek? Yeah, Chakotay Creek?
Chakotay Creek.
All right, sounds good. The aqueduct was completed around 1824 and was one of the final structures built before Roanoke Canal opened. Originally designed to have two keystone arches by North Carolina State Engineer Hamilton Fulton, the final structure was changed on site to have only one. The arch's foundations was cut directly into the hard granite bedrock. Precisely cut stone blocks were then placed without the use of mortar into an arch spanning the creek again. Only gravity holds them in place. Once each arch was completed, additional stone blocks were added on top
to create a 3 foot deep channel from one embankment to the other. A mixture of wet clay and sand called puddle was then layered into the bottom of the canal passage to make the aqueduct waterproof. In the 1890s, the Roanoke Canal was renovated for hydroelectric power, and that required a deeper channel. Since the aqueduct could not be dug out, the sides were built up 4 additional feet. Even with the increased weight and flow of water, the aqueduct remained firm until the canal was closed in the late 1910s. Since then, it has stood as a grand monument
to the engineering.
To the engineering ingenuity of the men who built the Roanoke Canal.
So, says there was a wine bottling plant nearby.
It says from the observation deck, several different types of stonework are visible that mark where improvements and repairs to the aqueduct have been made over the years. A, the original aqueduct only required a channel 3 feet deep, so it was several feet shorter from the top than it appears today. B, in the 1890s, the canal owners deepened the aqueduct by building up the channel walls. The top 4 feet of stone are recognized by their darker color and different tooling marks where they were cut. C, several floods called freshets were responsible for causing extensive damage over the lifespan of the canal. Major floods in 1834 and 1850 threatened to close the canal. The repaired abutment on the right side of the aqueduct seen from the overlook was the result of high waters washing it out in 1910. In 1912, another flood occurred that washed out the other portions of the canal, consequently closing it for good.
So the overlook is this wooden decking. A lot of sycamore trees here. This one's right in front of us.
Yeah. So it may not be clear that this was a canal. We would be standing in water 3 feet deep, the original canal. And they raised it up 4 feet more for power generation. But if she pans back there, you could tell. You can see how the banks are built up, how this is cut down. It's probably filled in. It was probably actually a little lower. And then there you can see there. The aqueduct,
yeah,
to carry the canal, all the water and over that creek. Because if that aqueduct wasn't there, you would have had to stop. They would have had to put a dam here. They'd had to stop. Then they had to carry the cargo, the goods, across the creek. Obviously, it would be a bridge or something there, and then put them back on another barge to go. So by putting the aqueduct there, the barge would start somewhere and go somewhere. I don't know where this canal started and stopped, but in the 1810s, teens, and 20s, canal building was a big deal. The Erie Canal up in Pennsylvania, all those were big, and North Carolina was putting in canals. The railroads totally blew this away because the railroads were way less expensive to build. Plus, in North Carolina, it wasn't a problem, but up north, the canals would freeze over so you couldn't move goods in the wintertime.
Sure.
But North Carolina, the canal at least could probably stay open most of the time, year round.
And just to say, we can definitely smell the wastewater treatment plant now.
She had to mention that.
I did. So this is Weldon Mills. They hold distillery tours. This is the end of the trail on the other side, the other end, although we switched towns now, we're in Weldon. And this is where the falls are, and there's lots of parking here.
Yep.
Oh, I see the falls are to the left.
Oh, we cool.
Oh, wow.
We're not, we don't have time to stay.
No.
I'm just going to come up here and spin around.
So okay. Yeah, we just did the math, and in order to get back on time for Johnny, we can't explore here more than what we're just going to do from this view. Wow, that's pretty, though. Really pretty. New men. All right, we're plugged in and charging in Halifax. Are you going to go inside, use the restroom?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, me too. What are we getting?
We're getting 75 kilowatts right now. Not very good. 77.
78. Yeah, that would not be as good 80. As we would prefer, especially at 33 miles.
Yeah, but it is going up.
Okay. It is what it is.
And we're at 33.
That's five cars charging. And we heard a rumor that there were going to be more chargers added. Maryland, Virginia, and well, we know we're from North Carolina. But remember, we're just south of the Virginia border.
So this is a little strange. So it says 1 minute to continue your trip here. Over here it says 5 minutes, and it says minus 20% to home. It's like, now it's doing calculating over here. Enough to continue trip. So this has changed over here now. And it says we'll get home at 12%. So I'm gonna say that we're good. Is that 10%? I can't see. I think that's 10 or 12% to home at 542. And it says we're gonna get to work at 509. So I think we're gonna be pulling out here. We have enough to continue the trip. That was kind of nice.
Making good time back to downtown Raleigh. I had me a nice nap. Poor Don, he's drinking iced tea, staying awake, obviously. Getting us back there. I knew I was gonna fall asleep. You can't get up at 5 a.m. hardly and not need a nap. Only problem is Johnny's not just left Greensboro just a little bit ago, and it's 90 minutes, so we're going to be back downtown significantly ahead of him, but better than being later than him significantly. So, and all this under here on the is traffic coming out of Raleigh. Wow, it's backed up. We didn't pass no accident or nothing.
Nope.
Cause I mean, it's really backed up over there. It's not, they're not moving at speed and they're packed. We've got 12 miles to the Beltline, so we're not exactly close to downtown yet either. Well, we were going to get home with 14%, which is totally fine, but it's looking like Johnny may be not be back to Raleigh until close to 6:30, and it's going on 5 o'clock. So we're going to go to North Hills and check out the added supercharger pedestals over there. They have some old 150 kilowatt, and they've added some new 250 kilowatt, and we haven't been there. Use the restroom at Target. I'll look for Hot Wheels. We'll stretch our legs and then we'll go back over to the university.
Yep.
Yeah, I had thought that touring three college campuses over in the Greensboro area today was a little bit industrious, but ambitious, I guess, was what I want to say. And it sounds like it was. But hopefully they've had a good time. No harm, no foul. Little bit of a long day for us, but nothing we can't handle. I was remiss in not telling you guys that when we left the supercharger, Don had autopilot.
Oh, right.
I don't know. We may not have been paying close attention leaving the canal around the canal, but anyway, Don's had autopilot the way home. Yeah, so what they did here is they doubled the size of the supercharger. And all of the new 250 kilowatt ones are on this end. The ones we'll see when we first come up here to the next stop sign. God, that was a terrible pothole there. But they had painted it, but that was a terrible pothole. And the sun's bright, so you're not really being able to see, I'm sure.
So here's the new cabinet on our left that they added for the new chargers, I guess.
Yeah.
Has a cipher lock.
What does that mean? What do you want me to do?
Go where
the only
want to
superchargers
go.
We know of where they have a 150 kilowatt sign on top.
And these have a 250 kilowatt sign. I would have been shocked if there were any of the Tesla ones here, and there aren't. Well, there are two Lucid Air. So now you can be your favorite Funko Pop character. Wow, the small 3.5 foot tall inflatables here are $25. They're still $16.88 at Walmart.
So there's 24 now, 12 old ones and 12 new ones. They also have a EV level 2 charging, and this xDrive 40, whatever that is, BMW pulled up and plugged in. It's an X5, it's a hybrid, I guess.
Ruby's at 80% or something close to 80%. She just stopped charging. It's 6:01 p.m. 15 minutes back to the school, and Johnny ought to be there around 6:30. He's near South Point Mall in Durham now. Goodness, look at all the runners.
Really?
Dang.
I don't think I've ever seen
Makes me feel like I need to get out there and start running. Yep, this is it.
St. Monica's is looking pretty in the sunset light. The Virginia creeper vine on the smokestack. All nice and red for fall.